Hello all. So now we will be discussing about the revision series of autocoids chapter. Now, what are autocoids? Autocoids, remember, they are known as local hormones. Okay. For the complete list of autocoids, you can see a photo which we have posted on a group. Now, in this, we will be discussing various autocoids like histamine and the drugs acting on histaminic receptors. We will be discussing about serotonin. And with serotonin, we will be discussing about the treatment of migraine. Then we will be discussing about lipid autocoids like prostaglandins and the drugs which inhibit prostaglandin synthesis known as NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And we will be discussing the uses of certain NSAIDs like in arthritis conditions. So we will be discussing about various treatment of arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis, gout, etc. So this is the main index or the agenda of our chapter, autocoids. So the first chapter we will be discussing about is histamine. So the questions which are related to histamine we will be discussing at first. Okay, so let's start with the first one, that is histamine. Now the first question is asking that which of the following H1 blocker has high anticholinergic activity. Remember, antihistaminic drug with anticholinergic activity, they are first generation antihistaminic. Okay, so antihistaminics, they are divided into first and second generation. Remember, only first generation antihistaminic, they have anticholinergic property, and among them chlorpheniramine is the first generation antihistaminic. Rest, cetirizine, it's a second generation. Fexofenadine, which comes with the brand name Allegra. Estimazole is a second generation. So only chlorpheniramine is the first generation antihistaminic. Now, which of the following drug blocks both histaminic receptor as well as 5-HT2? Remember, 5-HT2 are the receptors of serotonin, because another name of serotonin is 5-hydroxytryptamine. Now, remember, the only antihistaminic drug with anti-serotonin property is cyproheptadine. Okay, so only cyproheptadine is the only antihistaminic drug with anti-serotonin blocking property. It blocks the receptor of serotonin. Because of this reason, this cyproheptadine is used in the treatment of migraine. Okay, it is also used in the treatment of serotonin syndrome. It is also given in the treatment of serotonin secreting tumors known as carcinoid tumors. Okay, because it is the only antihistaminic drug with anti-serotonin blocking property. Now the next question is asking, a 15-year-old boy which was stung by a bee. He had difficulty in breathing and facial edema. What is the best treatment? As you see this question, the boy suffered from type 1 hypersensitivity or type 1 allergic reaction, which is also known as anaphylaxis. Now remember, the drug of choice for anaphylaxis is, remember, it is intramuscular adrenaline is considered as a drug of choice for anaphylaxis. It is given in a dose of around 0.05 ml of 1:1000. 1:1000 is also known as 1 milligram per ml of adrenaline. It is considered as a drug of choice for anaphylaxis. Hence, the answer is B, intramuscular adrenaline. Okay. Now, which of the following drugs and active metabolite combination are true? Let's see the true combination. If you talk about hydroxyzine is a drug whose active metabolite is cetirizine, the answer is absolutely true. The active metabolite of hydroxyzine is cetirizine. Okay. Terfenadine, fexofenadine, it is absolutely true. Loratadine, desloratadine, it's absolutely true. So the incorrect statement is C, chlorpromazine and promethazine. Remember, chlorpromazine is rather an antipsychotic drug, while promethazine is an antihistaminic drug. So the incorrect statement is C. Now, which of the following is not a second generation antihistaminic? So you have to find the first generation antihistaminic. The answer for this first generation antihistaminic is cyclizine. So for the complete list, you can see the video series or the list we have posted in our group. of the drugs among first and second generation histamine. Remember, all these drugs are second generation antihistaminic, BCD. Cyclizine is first generation. Now, second generation antihistaminic used in allergic rhinitis. So, among them, you have to find second generation. The answer is azelastine, fexofenadine, and desloratidine. Okay, so these are second generation. Rest C and E are first generation antihistaminic. Now, which of the following drugs can cause hypotension by release of histamine from the mast cell? The answer is morphine. So let's understand this concept, why morphine causes release of histamine from the mast cell. Suppose this is a mast cell. Remember, in mast cell we have histamine stores, and this histamine is a basic molecule, and this histamine in mast cell is bound to a molecule known as heparin, and heparin is an acidic substance. Okay, even you must know that heparin is the strongest acidic substance of our body. Now the point is, when we give any basic drug from outside, these basic drugs, they have a propensity that they themselves will bind to heparin, and this histamine will become free and it will release histamine, and these type of reactions are known as anaphylactoid reaction. So it is just like anaphylaxis, anaphylactoid reaction. So remember, any basic drug, it has a propensity to release histamine from the mast cell. So those basic drugs which can release histamine from the mast cells are, we will write morphine. That is why the side effect of morphine is asthma. And morphine also causes pruritus because of the release of histamine. Similarly, we will write vancomycin. Vancomycin is also a basic drug. Vancomycin causes severe rashes, which is the most common side effect, and it also causes red man syndrome. Similarly, any drug with curare group can also release histamine from the mast cell, like D-tubocurare. So try to remember these names. Okay, so these are the examples of certain basic drugs that you must remember. Now the eighth question is asking, all of the following statements are true about second generation antihistaminic agents except. Now let's talk about, they do not impair psychomotor performance. The answer is absolutely true. Why? Because second generation antihistaminic drug, they do not cross blood-brain barrier, and they do not have anticholinergic property. They do not have anticholinergic property. Okay, so this is a true statement. These drugs, they possess high anti-motion sickness activity. The answer is absolutely false. Because anti-motion sickness activity, the drug must cross blood-brain barrier. It must enter into ear, into labyrinthine, which is a part of brain. So remember, second generation antihistaminic, they don't have anti-motion sickness activity because they must enter into the brain, into inner ear, and they must block the receptors of histamine on ear. As these drugs, they cannot enter into the brain, hence they do not possess anti-motion sickness activity. Hence this activity question is false. They lack anticholinergic property. The answer is absolutely true. They may possess additional anti-allergic mechanism. It is true. Now remember, A, C and D options are true, and this A, C and D, which is the true statement, is the definition of second generation antihistaminic. It is the definition of second generation antihistaminic. Now the question ninth is asking, anti-vertigo drug which modulate calcium channels and have prominent labyrinthine suppressant property. Now remember, all first generation antihistaminic drug, they inhibit vestibular nerves in our inner ear. But among this first generation antihistaminic drug, there is one drug which can also block calcium channels on vestibular nerve. Additionally, that drug is cinarizine. Cinarizine has an additional calcium channel blocking property on vestibular nerve also. That is why it is a very good drug for anti-vertigo, anti-motion sickness, seasickness, etc. Now, H1 antihistaminic drug having best topical activity, that the drug is azelastine. So let's write the names of certain topical antihistaminic drug. So if you want to write the names of antihistaminic drug which are given topically as an eye drops or nasal drops are, we will write Koala. So the drug is ketotifen, given as an eye drop, nasal drop also, olopatadine, azelastine, levocarbastine, and L-Caftadine. So these are the drugs which have topical activity, and among them you are seeing the option azelastine is given. Okay, so they have topical activity. Now let's come to 11th question. Two antihistaminic drug, terfenadine and estimazole, were withdrawn from the market following the occurrence of cardiac arrhythmia when they were present in high blood level in the blood. These effects were highlighted by, the answer for this question number 11 is, we will write D, treatment of this patient with erythromycin, a CYP3A4 inhibitor. So let's talk about what this point means. There were two, second generation antihistaminic were estimazole and terfenadine. They were the first drugs to be developed in second generation antihistaminic. Now these two drugs, they are degraded in our body by an enzyme known as CYP3A4 enzyme. Now the point is, erythromycin and one more drug we will write, ketoconazole. These two drugs, remember, they are CYP3A4 inhibitor. They inhibit the level of CYP3A4. Because of this reason, their blood level increased, because they are degraded by CYP3A4, and in blood level is increased, they will produce toxicity. Now, in what is their toxicity, we will write, they will block potassium channel on heart. They block potassium channel on heart. Now, remember, any drug that blocks potassium channel on heart can lead to increase in QT interval on ECG. Okay, and if QT interval is increased, they can cause a very fatal ventricular fibrillation. They can cause a fatal ventricular fibrillation. That fatal ventricular fibrillation is known as torsades de pointes. Hence, it may cause sudden death in a person. Because of this reason, this estimazole and terfenadine got banned because of the use of erythromycin and ketoconazole, which were CYP3A4 inhibitors. Okay, now which of the following drug, if given with terfenadine, can cause ventricular arrhythmia? We have already discussed, the answer is ketoconazole. Okay, now antihistaminic drug which is used in motion sickness, try to find the first generation antihistaminic drug. Remember, only first generation antihistaminic drugs are used in motion sickness. The answer is here is diphenhydramine. Okay, but remember, meclizine has recently been approved for motion sickness as well. Okay, diphenhydramine is used, but meclizine has also been recently approved for motion sickness. A highway truck driver was found to was having profuse rhinorrhea, a highway truck driver, and sneezing. That means the patient is having allergic symptoms. Which of the following drug would you prescribe? Now the point is, as this highway truck driver needs a constant and continuous attention, we must not give first generation antihistaminic. Remember, first generation antihistaminic should not be given in the people who require close attention, because they are highly sedative drug. A person can sleep. Hence, we must give second generation antihistaminic, because second generation antihistaminic drugs are non-sedative. Except cetirizine. The only second generation which is sedative is cetirizine. So among them, if you find which is the second generation antihistaminic, the answer is fexofenadine. Okay, and overall, remember, fexofenadine is the least sedative or non-sedative antihistaminic drug, so we will prescribe fexofenadine to this patient. Okay, now H3 receptor agonists exhibit all of the following action except. Now how to solve this question? Now remember, what are the different receptors of histamine? Remember, the receptors of histamine are H1, H2, H3 and H4. Now, H1 receptor is GQ type, which increases IP3 DAC. H2 is GS type, which increases cyclic AMP. H3 is a presynaptic autoreceptor. And it is GI type. How to remember? Remember, it reduces the activity of both H1 and H2. It will reduce the activity of both H1 and H2 receptor. And H4 is present on WBC. It is also GI type and it is responsible for chemotaxis. It is responsible for chemotaxis. Now the point is, what is the function of H1 receptor? H1 receptor, remember, mediates allergy. And in CNS, it has various functions like it is responsible for vertigo. It is responsible for Parkinson's disease. It is responsible for vomiting, etc. It is also responsible for wakefulness. H2 receptor is present on stomach and it is responsible for increase in HCl production. Can we say if we will give an H3 receptor, if we will stimulate H3 receptor, it will decrease the activity of everything. So, can we say it inhibits H1 receptor, induce wakefulness? The answer is absolutely true. H1 receptor is responsible for wakefulness. That is why antihistaminic drugs, they cause sedation. They increase in H1 mediated gastrin release. The answer is absolutely false. So this is the answer, because H1, H3 receptor will not increase anything. Gastrin, remember, causes increases HCl. It causes inhibition of H1 mediated bronchoconstriction, which will occur due to allergic reaction. The answer is absolutely true. It has negative or depressing effect on atria. The answer is absolutely true. So just remember, wherever the H3 receptor will occur, it will inhibit everything. So this point you have to remember only. You don't have to remember everything. Just remember, H3 receptor reduces everything. So the correct answer for this question is B. So this is the false statement B. Okay. Now all of the following actions of histamines are mediated by H1 receptor except. The answer for this question is, 16th question is, we will write, is direct action on vascular smooth muscles causing vasodilatation. Remember, histamine causes vasodilatation not by a direct action. Okay? Remember, directly if it will act on smooth muscles, suppose this is a blood vessels. Remember, in blood vessels we have endothelial cells. And on endothelial cell we have H1 receptor. And below endothelial cell we have smooth muscles. On smooth muscles we also have H1 receptor. Now the point is, histamine causes contraction of smooth muscles. So if we give histamine and it is acting on smooth muscle, it will produce vasoconstriction, not vasodilatation. But when histamine comes and act on endothelial cell, this endothelial cell produces nitric oxide gas. And this nitric oxide acts as a releasing, it causes vasodilatation. It relaxes smooth muscle. That is why nitric oxide is known as endothelial derived relaxing factor, because it causes vasodilatation. So can we say that histamine produces vasodilatation indirectly by producing nitric oxide gas? But if it is acting directly on a smooth muscle, suppose the blood vessel is damaged, the endothelial cell is damaged, it will rather produce vasoconstriction. So remember this part, wherever the smooth muscle part is present, remember, histamine causes contraction of smooth muscles. That is why it will also cause bronchoconstriction also. Okay? So remember this part. So this is the incorrect statement B. Now all of the following antihistaminic drugs lack anticholinergic property. Now the point is, you have to find second generation antihistaminic. Remember, the second generation antihistaminic here are estimazole, levocetrizine and loratadine. So all second generation antihistaminic will lack anticholinergic property, but remember, promethazine is the first generation antihistaminic, so it will possess anticholinergic property. So the answer is, it will have anticholinergic property, promethazine, because it is first generation antihistaminic. And remember, among all antihistaminic drugs, maximum anticholinergic property is of promethazine. Okay, so remember this part. Now the question 18, the antihistaminic drug that can cause cardiac arrhythmia at high dose by blocking cardiac potassium channel. It is most likely to be, we have already discussed, terfenadine and estimazole. And these two antihistaminic drugs, they got banned also because they were causing torsades de pointis. Ketoconazole should not be given to a patient being treated with estimazole. We have already known, because ketoconazole inhibit the metabolism of estimazole and estimazole can produce cardiac arrhythmia. Hence the answer is you will write, the answer is dangerous ventricular arrhythmia can occur, which are known as torsades de pointis. So if you see the first question, first option, ketoconazole induce the metabolism, it is false. It rather inhibit the metabolism of estimazole. That is why toxicity occur. Estimazole inhibit the metabolism? No, it is rather opposite. Ketoconazole inhibit the metabolism. Estimazole antagonize the antifungal action of ketoconazole? No. Estimazole is rather an antihistaminic drug. Ketoconazole is a antifungal drug. They both are different class. So answer is B. Now, which of the following can reverse one or the more smooth muscle effect of circulating histamine? Remember, the answer for this question number 20 is ranitidine. Because ranitidine is an H2 blocker. It is histamine receptor blocker. And some amount of histamine receptor are also present on smooth muscles as well. So the answer is ranitidine. The long acting classical first generation antihistaminic include which of the following? So we have to find first generation antihistaminic. The answer is chlorpheniramine. Okay. Now which of the following is not used as a sedative but causes sedation as a side effect? The answer is antihistaminic drug and antidepressant drug. Now why antidepressant drug? Because antidepressant drug, they also possess antihistaminic property because of this reason. Now fexofenadine is a product of, the answer is terfenadine. We have already discussed the active form of terfenadine is fexofenadine. This fexofenadine, it comes with the brand name Allegra. Histamine blocker in stomach act through, we have already discussed that H2 receptors are present in stomach and they are GH type. And they increases cyclic AMP level. So if we talk about H2 blocker will decrease cyclic AMP level inside the stomach. Because of this reason, it will decrease gastrin release and it will also decrease HCl production through parietal cells of stomach. Hence the answer for this question is decreasing cyclic AMP in the stomach. Okay. A 70-year-old man was administered penicillin IV. Within 5 minutes, he developed generalized urticaria, swelling of lips, hypotension, bronchospasm. These are the features of, remember, anaphylactic shock. Because if there is hypotension, so you'll write anaphylactic shock. And remember, the drug of choice for anaphylaxis, we have already discussed, is epinephrine injection. Okay. Epinephrine, remember, is also known as adrenaline. We have already discussed about the dose also. Epinephrine or adrenaline, they both are same thing. European people, they call them as adrenaline. American people, they call it as epinephrine. The most common side effect of antihistaminic drug, remember, if you talk about is sedation. Okay. And it is with first generation mainly. Now H3 receptor inverse agonist, recently approved for narcolepsy, a new drug is Tiprolisant. The drug Tiprolisant, which is also known as, the another name of Tiprolisant is Pitolisant. It is the only drug we have which is acting on H3 receptor and it is H3 receptor inverse agonist. Okay. And it has been approved for the treatment of narcolepsy. So it's an antihistaminic drug. Now remember, overall the drug of choice for narcolepsy to maintain wakefulness is modafinil. Modafinil is a sympathomimetic drug. It increases sympathetic discharge. But remember, recently, this Tiprolisant has also been approved for narcolepsy. And this is all about histamine. Thank you very much. Hello all. So now let's discuss about the second autocoid, that is serotonin. And with serotonin, we will also discuss the treatment of migraine. Okay, so let's go through the MCQs in rapid revision. So the first question is asking, ergometrin is not used for initiation of labor. Now what is ergometrin? Remember, ergometrin is an ergot alkaloid. It's an ergot alkaloid. And as the word metrin is coming, remember it acts on myometrium. Now myometrium word means it is acting on uterus. As it is acting on uterus, it will cause uterine contraction. Because of this reason, if the uterus is contracted, remember what are the uses. If you talk about the use, it is used for postpartum hemorrhage. It is used for controlling postpartum hemorrhage. But remember, it is absolutely contraindicated for induction and augmentation of labor. To promote labor, it is absolutely contraindicated. Why? Because it causes very uneven and sometimes very strong contraction, which can lead to fetal hypoxia. Okay? It can lead to fetal hypoxia. Because of the reason of danger of fetal hypoxia, it is never given in induction of labor. Now remember, whether it is postpartum hemorrhage or induction of labor, now the drug of choice for both cases has become oxytocin. The drug of choice for both induction of labor and postpartum hemorrhage has become oxytocin. So the answer for this question number one is it causes fetal hypoxia. Hence, it is not given for initiation of labor. Now, which of the following drug is useful in prophylaxis of migraine? So let's discuss in summary, what is the acute treatment of migraine when the patient will come to you? How would you treat an acute attack of migraine? And what are the drugs you will give for prophylaxis of chronic migraine? Okay, prophylaxis of chronic migraine. Chronic migraine means if the headache is occurring for more than 15 days a month. So both have different treatment, acute migraine and prophylaxis. What are the drugs used? So let's talk about those drugs. So this is the drugs which we use for the treatment of acute attack of migraine. As you are seeing, for mild cases of migraine, we use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Okay, and we can give a simple one drug like paracetamol, aspirin, etc., naproxen. But sometimes we can combine them also. They are used in mild cases of acute attack of migraine, and they are also preferred in pregnancy. Now let's move to the next step. When it is not controlled by aspirin or NSAID, or in moderate to severe variety, the drug of choice is triptans. Okay, and triptans are overall considered as a drug of choice for acute attack of migraine. So this group is known as triptans. The drugs are known as sumatriptan, rizatriptan, etc. The second class of drug we can give is ergot. Ergot also act on 5-HT, that is serotonin receptor 1B1D agonist. But remember, they are never combined. They can lead to severe hypertension. If it is still not controlled, we give dopamine blocker or D2 blockers. And dopamine blocker, they are more effective in controlling the associated symptoms of migraine known as aura, like nausea, vomiting, etc. So we can give various dopamine blockers like metoclopramide, domperidone, prochlorperazine, chlorpromazine, etc. And lastly, in resistant cases, the only option we are left with is opioids. Because opioids, why they are given in last? Because they are the addictive drugs. We don't prefer to give them in first choice. So you can give oral and IV drugs like morphine, pethidine. The only intranasal opioid we have is butorphanol. Okay. And there is a new drug which is under clinical trial, that is 5-HT1F agonist, lesmeditan. But right now it is not approved, lesmeditan. So you have to remember what is triptans. Triptans is 5-HT1B1D agonist. They stimulate serotonin 1B1D receptors. Now this is the drugs we have for the acute attack of migraine. Now let's come to the drugs for prophylaxis of migraine. In prophylaxis of migraine, we give in chronic migraine when the patient is having headache for more than 15 days a month, for continuously for 3 months. The drug of choice for prophylaxis of migraine is beta blocker. which beta blocker we give. Propranolol is considered as a drug of choice. If it is not controlled by beta blocker, then we start with anti-epileptic drugs like valproic acid, topiramate, gabapentin and pregabalin. Other drugs which were used but less effective as compared to beta blocker and anti-epileptics are calcium channel blockers, known as flunarizine and verapamil. Verapamil also acts on heart. Tricyclic antidepressants, amitriptyline, nortriptyline, anti-serotonin drug, ketanserine and ciproheptadine. Methysergide was the first drug for migraine. It was an ergot, it got banned because of retroperitoneal fibrosis. Now we have certain new drugs for migraine, certain monoclonal antibody for migraine. The drug you have to remember is erinumab. Erinumab is a monoclonal antibody that blocks CGRP protein. CGRP is an inflammatory protein released by neurons which starts migraine headache. So CGRP stands for calcitonin gene related peptide. The other two new approved drugs which are just like erinumab are fremanezumab and galcinezumab. Olaquizumab and telaquizumab are also CGRP antagonists, but they are not approved yet. A herbal drug, pitasites, can also be used. Pitasite is also known as butterbur plant. So these are the drugs we have for prophylaxis of migraine. Keep this thing in mind. Remember, the drug of choice for prophylaxis is beta blockers. And drug of choice for acute attack is considered to be triptans. Okay? Triptans. So let's come to our question number 2. Which of the following drug is used in prophylaxis of migraine? The answer is propranolol. While triptans, ergots and domperidone, which is a D2 blocker, they are given in acute attack. All other drugs are given in acute attack. The answer is propranolol. It is considered as a drug of choice for prophylaxis of migraine. Okay? Now, which of the following drug is useful in acute attack of migraine? The question is asking about acute attack. The answer is sumatriptan, which is considered as a drug of choice for acute attack of migraine, triptans. Okay? It was 5-HT1B1D agonist, if you remember. It stimulates with serotonin receptor, 5-HT1B1D agonist. Okay? Now, which of one of the following is a contraindication of using ergot derivatives? Now, ergot derivatives, remember, are of various types. Some ergot derivatives stimulate dopamine 2 receptor, dopamine 2 agonist. Certain ergot derivatives, they are serotonin agonist. They stimulate serotonin receptors like 5-HT1B1D. And certain, they stimulate oxytocin receptor. So we have these various kinds of ergot. Now the drugs which are given in D2 agonist, remember, they suppress prolactin release from pituitary. They are given in prolactinomas. They are also given in Parkinson's disease. So these are the two uses of D2 agonist ergot, Parkinson's disease. The drug which are given in serotonin 5-HT1B1D agonist and oxytocin agonist, they are given in acute attack of migraine. And the drug which stimulate oxytocin receptor, they are given for the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. So, let's see what are the those ergot alkaloid we have, which are used for this condition. The D2 agonist ergot alkaloid we have is bromocriptine. It is considered as a drug of choice for prolactinoma in pregnancy. Overall drug of choice for prolactinoma is cabergoline. We have other drugs also like quinagolide, etc. In acute attack of migraine, we give ergotamine and dihydroergotamine. These two ergots are used in acute attack of migraine. They are 5-HT1B1D agonist. Okay. Now, oxytocin agonist, we have ergometrin. Remember, ergometrin is also known as ergonovin. We have methyl ergometrin. We will write E for ergometrin, which is also known as methergin. We have dihydroergometrin, etc. They are given for the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Now, what is the common side effects of ergot? If you talk about the common side effects of ergots, remember, ergots, they cause postural hypotension because they dilate the larger veins due to the action of D2 receptor, D2 agonist. Their most common side effect is nausea and vomiting. Again, due to D2 agonist. Now, these ergots, they cause obstructive vascular disease. Which obstructive vascular disease? We will write, they may cause Raynaud's disease. They may cause coronary vasospasm or vasospastic angina. Now, why, sir? Because they cause vasoconstriction of end arteries. Remember, dopamine causes vasodilatation of larger artery. Vasoconstriction of end arteries is due to serotonin. And lastly, they may cause abortion because of oxytocin receptor agonist. So they have effect on all receptors, but we have discussed predominant receptors. Okay. They may also cause, because of obstructive lung disease, they may cause erythromelalgia. They also cause dry gangrene of limbs because of ischemia, dry gangrene of limbs. Dry gangrene of limbs. And sometimes they may cause retroperitoneal fibrosis also or inflammatory fibrosis also, which is not important. So keeping this thing in mind about a whole summary of ergots, let's talk about the question number 4. The question number 4 is asking, which of the following is a contraindication to the use of ergot derivatives? Can we use ergot derivative in migraine? The answer is true. We use ergotamine, dihydroergotamine. They are used in hyperprolactinoma. True. We use bromocriptine in pregnancy. Overall drug of choice for prolactinoma is cabergoline. They are given in postpartum hemorrhage. True. Like ergometrin. Okay. Methyl ergometrin, known as methergine. So they are absolutely contraindicated in obstructive vascular disease. Okay. So they are absolutely contraindicated in obstructive vascular disease like Raynaud's disease, coronary vasospasm, erythromelalgia, dry gangrene of limbs. This is their side effect. Okay. Now let's talk about the question number 5. Serotonin can be synthesized from. Remember, serotonin is synthesized from an amino acid known as tryptophan. Okay. So remember, if you talk about serotonin, serotonin is synthesized from tryptophan. How? First, tryptophan is hydroxylated and it gets converted into 5-hydroxytryptophan. So here with the enzyme which is required is tryptophan hydroxylase. Then the enzyme tryptophan decarboxylase acts. It converts it into 5-hydroxytryptamine. Because if you will remove carbon dioxide from an amino acid, the only part which will remain is amine. Hence, it is known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. Now, 5-hydroxytryptamine is another name of serotonin. Serotonin is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. That is why the receptors of serotonin are also known as 5-HT receptors. Hence, it is known as short form of 5-hydroxytryptamine is 5-HT. So, it is synthesized from tryptophan. Okay. So, I want to share a new drug which inhibits tryptophan hydroxylase enzyme. That drug name is trilotristat ethyl. There is a new drug which inhibits this enzyme, tryptophan hydroxylase. And this drug has recently been approved for the tumors of cells which secrete high level of serotonin known as carcinoid tumors. It has been approved for carcinoid tumors. Now the next question is asking, tryptophan is used in migraine headache. We know that tryptophans are used in migraine headache. They act as an agonist at which receptor? We already know the answer. They are 5-HT1B1D agonist. So tryptans, they are 5-HT1B1D agonist like sumatriptan, rizatriptan, etc. And they are considered as a drug of choice for acute attack of migraine. Now, ergometrin is used for, if you remember, ergometrin was used for postpartum hemorrhage. Okay, postpartum hemorrhage. The drug possessing antagonistic action at histamine, serotonin and muscarinic receptor is, this we have already discussed in histaminic chapter only, ciproheptadine. Ciproheptadine is the only first generation antihistaminic drug which also has anticholinergic as well as anti-serotonin blocking property. Okay, ciproheptadine. Next is, which of the following serotonin receptor is an autoreceptor? Autoreceptor means, suppose there is a nerve, it is releasing serotonin. Normally, serotonin will act on other organs. So let's talk about, suppose we say the receptors of serotonin are present on other organs. This area is generally known as synapse, and these receptors are known as postsynaptic receptors. But remember, certain receptors of serotonin are present on the same neuron which is releasing serotonin, and these receptors are known as presynaptic autoreceptor. Now, overall serotonin has 5HT1 to 5HT7 receptors. There are 7 receptors of serotonin. Now, the first point is, the only receptor which is present on presynaptic neuron is 5HT1. 5HT1 receptors are presynaptic autoreceptors, and rest all other 5HT2 to 5HT7, they are postsynaptic receptors. Okay? So if you see this option, the answer is B. 5HT1B and 1D, because one word is coming. Now the second point you will write, that all receptors of serotonin 1 to 7, they are G protein coupled receptors. G protein coupled receptors are also known as metabotrophic receptors, except 5HT3. 5HT3 is an ionotropic receptor which conducts sodium. Okay, so all the receptors of serotonin are GPCR, metabotrophic, G protein coupled, except 3, which is an ionotropic receptor. So this is all about the receptors of serotonin. So now the selective 5HT4 agonist used in GERD and lacking an arrhythmogenic property is, now remember, 5HT4 receptor is present in our intestine and in our stomach. It is present in our stomach and intestine. So it is present in GIT. And serotonin, remember, when serotonin acts on 5HT2 receptor, it increases motility of stomach and intestine. As the motility of stomach and intestine will increase, the food which is present inside the stomach will come down. Hence, as they are increasing the motility of GIT, they are known as prokinetic drugs. So remember, 5HT4 agonist, these drugs, they are known as prokinetic drugs. Now, where they are used? First, they will increase the motility of stomach. The food will come into the intestine rapidly. Hence, the food will not reflux back to the intestine, into the esophagus. The food will not go back to the esophagus. Hence, they are used in the treatment of GERD. And the food which is present in the intestine will rapidly eliminated out of the body. Hence, they are used in the treatment of constipation. So, prokinetic drugs have two uses, GERD and constipation. Now, remember, 5HT4 agonist prokinetic drug, they end with the word pride. They end with the word pride, like sizapride, mozapride, benzapride, prucalopride. Okay? Now, this sizapride got banned. The sizapride got banned because of it was causing ventricular fibrillation or torsades de pointis. Okay? So, it was blocking potassium channel on the heart, hence it got banned. So, sizapride got banned. There was one more drug, just like sizapride, which got banned, was tigasirod. So, these two drugs, they got banned. Remember, tigasirod is not ending with the word pride, but it is also a 5HT4 agonist. Hence, the answer for this question number 10th is sizapride. Okay? Not prucalopride. Now, what is ketanserin? Remember, ketanserine is 5-HT2 antagonist. Okay? It is 5-HT2 antagonist. Where it is used? It will block the postsynaptic receptor. It is used in serotonin syndrome. It is used in carcinoid tumor. And it is also given in cases of prophylaxis of migraine, which we have already written. Now, any other drug which is a 5-HT2 antagonist? Yes, we will write cyproheptadine. It is also a 5-HT2 antagonist. We will also write antipsychotics like clozapine, olanzapine, etc. They are also 5-HT2 antagonists. So this is the complete list. Okay. Now ondansetron is, remember ondansetron, a very famous drug, is an anti-emetic drug. And this ondansetron is 5-HT3 antagonist. And remember, antagonist, 5-HT3 antagonist, they will end with the word cetron. They will end with the word cetron. And where this ondansetron is given? It is given as an anti-emetic drug because it will block the vomiting center of our brain known as CTZ area, chemoreceptor trigger zone. Where it is given? It is a drug of choice for chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, radiotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Chemotherapy means anti-cancer drug induced. When we give anti-cancer drug, they may cause nausea and vomiting. So ondansetron is given in chemotherapy and radiotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Now the next question, which we have already discussed, is we will write that sizapride is used in. So we have already discussed that sizapride is given in cases of gastroesophageal reflux disease. It was a prokinetic drug. Okay. Drugs used in prophylaxis of migraine are all except. So try to remember the list I showed you. So propranolol, yes, it is used. Topiramate, yes, anti-epileptic it is used. Flunarizine, yes, calcium channel blocker it is used. So the drug which is not used in prophylaxis of migraine is levetiracetam. It is also an anti-epileptic drug. Drug used for prophylaxis of migraine are. So let's talk about question number 15. We have discussed, yes, flunarizine is used in prophylaxis of migraine. It is a calcium channel blocker. Cinarizine, no. Cinarizine, remember, is an antihistaminic drug, no use. Beta blocker, propranolol, yes, they are the drug of choice. Anti-epileptic drug, valproate, yes. So only three anti-epileptic drugs are approved: valproate, topiramate, and gabapentin. Carbamazepine is also an anti-epileptic drug, but it is not given for prophylaxis of migraine. Okay. Selective 5-HT1B1D receptor agonist used in acute attack of migraine is very simple. Try to find the word triptan. The answer is fovartriptan. Okay. So these drugs are known as triptans. Now dihydroergotamine differs from ergotamine is. They both are used in acute attack of migraine. The answer is dihydroergotamine, it is more potent alpha blocker and it has less action on serotonin receptor, thereby it is less vasoconstrictor. Okay. So when we convert attached hydrogen group, it becomes more of an alpha blocker, and more of an alpha blocker will produce vasodilatation. Hence, it carries less risk of dry gangrene of limbs or Raynaud's disease. Choose the correct statement about sumatriptan. It activates 5-HT1 receptor. The answer is false. It rather activates 5-HT1B1D receptor. It is tend to suppress both pain and vomiting in migraine. The answer is true. Triptans, remember, they are given for the treatment of headache and they also decrease aura. Aura is the associated symptoms in migraine like nausea and vomiting. So they reduce both pain as well as aura. They do not carry the risk of vasospasm. The answer is false. Their main side effect is vasoconstriction. Triptans, they mainly cause vasoconstrictions just like ergots. Hence, they precipitate coronary vasospasm. They are absolutely contraindicated in angina patients. It is combined with ergotamine. Remember, they are never combined with ergotamine. Why? Because they have similar side effect. ergot side effect, which we have already discussed, and the side effect of triptans are similar. Hence, the true answer is B. Okay. Drug of choice for acute severe migraine, the answer is triptans. We already know. Which of the following is true about sumatriptan? It is antagonist of serotonin. False. It is rather agonist. It is not antagonist. It is rather agonist. 5-HT1B1D agonist. It interacts with beta alpha and beta receptor. False. It rather interacts with serotonin receptors. It has anti-migraine activity. Yes, it is the drug of choice for migraine. It can be given for treatment of ischemic heart disease. False. It is absolutely contraindicated because it may cause coronary vasospasm. It may also cause hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension. So the truth statement is this. So it is absolutely contraindicated in heart disease. Now all 5-HT receptors are heptahelical serpentine G protein coupled receptor except. So exception we had already discussed, if you remember, which receptor? 5-HT3 receptor is ionotropic receptor. Rest all other receptors were GPCR. Most important receptor involved in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Remember, we use Cetron wale drug in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, and they are 5-HT3 antagonists. Okay, and the answer for this question is serotonin 5-HT3 receptors. For question number 22, 5-HT3 receptor. Now, one of the following is not a 5-HT receptor antagonist. Okay. So the answer is, remember, for this question is, what is ketanserine? Remember, ketanserine is 5-HT2 antagonist. Okay. Methysergide is also 5-HT2 antagonist. Tropicetron word is coming, 5-HT3 antagonist. So the answer is lanreotide. What is lanreotide? Lanreotide is just like octreotide. Lanreotide and octreotide are both somatostatin hormone. They are somatostatin hormone analogs. So the answer is lanreotide. Now all of the following can be used for prophylaxis of migraine, except which is not used for prophylaxis of migraine is valproate, yes, anti-epileptic it is used, topiramate, yes, used, propranolol, yes, used, sumatriptan. Remember, triptans are only given for acute attack of migraine, not for prophylaxis. Okay, only for acute attack of migraine. They are contraindicated in prophylaxis. In prophylaxis, we give beta blocker, anti-epileptic drugs. Which of the following is most useful in reversing severe ergot induced vasospasm? The answer is we have to give vasodilator. Now the first point is ergotamine. The answer is no, it itself is an ergot. Methysergide, no, because it itself is an ergot. Now nitroprusside, as the word comes, it gives nitric oxide and it causes vasodilatation, and hence the spasm will be relieved. The answer is nitroprusside. Okay, so the answer is nitroprusside. What is phenoxybenzamine? Phenoxybenzamine is an alpha blocker. Okay, so the answer is nitroprusside. Okay, now let's come to the next question. Which of the following adverse effect is characteristically associated with methysergide? Now methysergide is an ergot derivative and it got banned because it was causing retroperitoneal fibrosis. Okay, and it was the first drug for migraine. There was one more ergot, you will write, just like methysergide, known as pergolide. Pergolide also got banned because it was causing cardiac and pulmonary fibrosis. So remember, ergots, they generally cause fibrosis of various organs. Because of this, they got banned, and the answer is retroperitoneal fibrosis. Ergot alkaloid commonly used to prevent postpartum hemorrhage. We have already discussed the answer. Try to find the word metrin. Why? Because they are acting on myometrium. They will contract uterus. And the answer is this one. Ergotamine is given in migraine. Dihydroergotamine is also given in migraine. Dihydroergotoxin is a nootropic drug. Nootropic means it increases memory. Hence, it is given in the treatment of memory loss or cognitive loss known as dementia. So, the answer is methyl ergometrin. Now, which of the following drug is used in the prophylaxis of migraine but not in angina pectoris? Now, the calcium channel blocker flunarizine. Okay. So, flunarizine is a calcium channel blocker. They all are calcium channel blocker. But flunarizine is a specific calcium channel blocker which act on neurons. So, it is only given in migraine. What about diltiazam and amlodipine? They are only given in angina. What about merapamil? Verapamil is given in both migraine and angina. So, verapamil is given in both. Verapamil is given in both migraine and angina. Flunarizine is only given in migraine. Diltiazam and amlodipine, they are only given in angina. Now, triptans. Sumatriptan is 5-HT. 1B, 1D, agonist. Here, B word is not coming. So, the answer you will mark is 5-HT, 1D, agonist. Which of the following drug act on 5-HT3 receptor? Try to find out cetron. We had already discussed. Ondansetron. Granisetron. Again, cetron. Anti-emetic action due to blockage of 5-HT3 receptor, which is a receptor of serotonin. A patient is receiving ketoconazole. He developed GERD. Which of the following drug should not be given? Same answer, sizapride. Sizapride, again, it is degraded by drug CYP3A4. And ketoconazole inhibits CYP3A4. Hence, the toxicity of sizapride occurred. And sizapride got banned because it was causing torsades de pointis. Okay? Just like two antihistaminic drug, estimazole and terfenadine. After taking a drug for acute attack of migraine, a patient developed nausea and vomiting, tingling and numbness on tip of the finger, which also turned blue. Can we say it is just like Raynaud's disease? Which of the following drug is most likely? We had already discussed nausea vomiting with Raynaud's disease is the classical side effect of ergots. This is known as ergotism. So the answer is find out dihydroergotamine. So please refer to the initial question where we have discussed all the side effects of ergots. So this is all about migraine and serotonin. Okay. So thank you very much. Hello all. So now let's discuss about the third autocoid part, that is prostaglandins. Okay. So before coming to the question, let's discuss about the certain basics of prostaglandin, learn about them, then we will solve the questions. So if you talk about what are prostaglandins, prostaglandins are derived from arachidonic acids. How arachidonic acid is formed? It is a part of cell membrane phospholipid. When there is a stimulus, phospholipase enzyme will act, which will break down this phospholipid and arachidonic acid will come into the cytoplasm. Now this arachidonic acid can form three things. It can form lipoxins in blue, prostaglandins in violet, and leukotrienes in black. Now for synthesis of lipoxins, CYP450 enzyme is required. For the synthesis of prostaglandins, cyclooxygenase or COX enzyme is required. And for the synthesis of leukotrienes, LOX enzyme or lipoxygenase enzyme is required. Now, if you talk about prostaglandin, this is how prostaglandins are formed. First of all, PGG2 and H2 are formed. And then depending upon the type of cell, different types of prostaglandins are synthesized. Like in platelets, you see that in platelets, there is an enzyme thromboxane synthase which will convert PGH2 into thromboxane A2. Okay? And this thromboxane A2 causes platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction. While an opposite substance is formed, which is considered as a physiological antagonist of thromboxane A2 in endothelial cells, that is prostacyclin or PGI2. It is an antiplatelet and it causes vasodilatation. And in all other tissues and many other tissues, PGD2, E2 and F2 alpha are synthesized. We will see their action. Now, two word here signifies the number of double bonds. And remember, PGE2 is a bronchodilator, PGF2 alpha is a bronchoconstrictor, and all PG causes uterine contractions. Now, if you talk about leukotrienes, leukotrienes contain three double bond, that is why they have a word trienes. First of all, leukotriene A4 is formed, which is converted into leukotriene B4. Leukotriene B4, remember, causes chemotaxis or recruitment of eosinophils. Then leukotriene C, D and E form. C and D, they are known as SRSA, slow reacting substance of anaphylaxis. They cause type 1 hypersensitivity or allergic reactions. So this is about the synthesis of prostaglandins and leukotriene. So let's talk about prostaglandin and their uses. So if you talk about the uses of prostaglandin, there are various types. If you see PGE1, PGE1 means with that we have saturated one double bond out of two double bonds. So we have misoprostol, it is used in three conditions: abortion up to 63 days, NSAID induced peptic ulcers, okay? Because NSAIDs, they reduce, inhibit COX enzyme, which synthesizes prostaglandin even in stomach. It is used for opening of ductus arteriosus in congenital heart disease like total anomalous pulmonary venous connections. The most common side effect of misoprostol is diarrhea. Why? It increases chloride secretion in intestine. It also causes pain and it causes a teratogenic abnormality. Misoprostol causes Möbius syndrome in fetus. Möbius syndrome is a malformation of sixth cranial nerve. Other nerves can also be involved. Then we have alprostadil, open ductus arteriosus, just like misoprostol. It is given for impotency like erectile dysfunction, and it is also given for critical limb ischemia. Lubiprostone is a chloride secretor. It is given for constipation associated irritable bowel syndrome. Gemiprost also causes uterine contraction and it is given for first trimester abortion. Then we have PGI2. PGI2, if you remember, it is a vasodilator. Hence, it is given for pulmonary hypertension. And it is also an antiplatelet drug given during hemodialysis. So there are three drugs: tri-prostinyl, iloprost and epoprostinol. If you talk about other prostaglandin, we have PGE2. E2 means dinoprostone. Now two word is coming, you will write second trimester abortion. E1, one word is coming, first trimester abortion. So it is the drug of choice for cervical ripening also, because E2 acts in lower segment of uterus, causes effacement or dilatation of cervix. It is also given for hydatiform mole removal. It also causes diarrhea, and this prostaglandin causes bone resorption or bone demineralization, which can lead to osteoporosis. Then we have PGF2 alpha, we have dinoprost. Again, two word is coming, second trimester abortion. Carboprost, given IV for postpartum hemorrhage. Resistant to oxytocin, because the drug of choice for postpartum hemorrhage is oxytocin. Then we have certain eye drops of PGF2 alpha analog, which are used in glaucoma. And they cause hair growth in eye, like eyelashes and eyebrows. Hence, they are given for the treatment of hypotrichosis. So they are also given in glaucoma, PGF2 alpha analog. So latanoprost, bimatoprost, travoprost, tafluprost and unoprostol. So keeping this summary in mind, let's solve the questions of prostaglandins now. Now the first question is, the prostaglandin derivatives are used in all of the following except. So you have to find the except statement. So if you have to find except statement, it is used as an abortifacient drug. It is absolutely true. Misoprostol like drug. Okay, true. It is given for cervical ripening. The answer is true. Dinoprostone is the drug of choice for cervical ripening, PGE2. Okay. Abortifacient, yes. E1, E2, F2 alpha, they are given in abortifacient. NSAID induced peptic ulcer, true. Like misoprostol, E1 analog is given for NSAID induced peptic ulcer. So the incorrect answer is patent ductus arteriosus closure. It is not closure, it is rather opening of patent ductus arteriosus. They are rather given for opening to maintain the patency of ductus arteriosus we give. Hence the false statement here is fourth one, that is fourth. Now latanoprost, PGF2 alpha analog, is used in, we know it is given as an eye drop and we know it is given in glaucoma. So the answer is glaucoma for latanoprost. Now, which of the following actions are performed by prostacyclin I2 analog? We have discussed that prostacyclin analog, it causes vasodilatation and antiplatelet. Because it causes vasodilatation, it is used in pulmonary hypertension and it inhibits platelet aggregation, hence it is an antiplatelet drug. given during hemodialysis. PGI2, hence this is the effect of PGI2 B. B is the answer. Okay. Now, misoprostol is an example of, I think we have already discussed, meso means mono. Mono means one. It is PGE1 analog. Okay. So, misoprostol is PGE1 analog. Now, L-prostadil is not used for. I told you three uses of L-prostadil. L-prostadil is also a PGE1 analog, just like misoprostol. It is given for opening of ductus arteriosus, true. It is given for erectile dysfunction, true. It is given for critical limb ischemia, true. So where it is not used? It is not given in pulmonary hypertension. In pulmonary artery hypertension, we rather use PGI2 analogs, not PGE1 analog, L-prostadil. The prostaglandins are synthesized from, I hope we already know, it is synthesized from arachidonic acid. And arachidonic acid is also known as icosa, tetra, enoic acid. It is also known as icosa tetraenoic acid. Now, icosa means it contains 20 carbon. Tetra means it contains 4. Enoic means double bond. So, arachidonic acid, icosa means 20. Tetra means 4. Enoic means double bonds. Now, all of the followings are true about prostaglandin E1, except we have to find the incorrect statement. It is the principal prostaglandin synthesized in stomach. The answer is absolutely true. PGE1, remember, it reduces HCl production. How it reduces HCl production? For that, you can go to the videos and there we have explained. And it also increases the protective factors like bicarbonate and mucus. Okay. So the whole mechanism is elaborated in videos. So, yes, it is true. It inhibits the biosynthesis by aspirin. The answer is true, because aspirin is a COX inhibitor, and all COX inhibitor, they reduce the production of prostaglandin. It stimulates gastric acid secretion. So this answer statement is false. So this statement is a false statement. It rather decreases HCl production. It is protective for stomach. It causes dilatation of submucosal vessel. The answer is true. It increases the blood supply to the stomach. Okay, so sometimes it can be given for stress ulcer also. Now, prostaglandins have effects on variety of tissues. The different prostaglandins may act in a different way. Which of the following statement is not correct? So we have to find the false statement. So if you want to follow the find statement, let's see. The first statement is asking that arterial smooth muscle is relaxed by PGE2 and I2. Yes, true. That is why they produce vasodilatation. And PG thromboxane A2 and PG F2 alpha causes vasoconstriction. It is absolutely true. That is why thromboxane A2 causes bronchoconstriction and vasoconstriction. PG F2 alpha also causes bronchoconstriction and vasoconstriction. It's absolutely true, first statement. PGI2 inhibit platelet aggregation, while thromboxane A2 facilitate platelet aggregation. We have already discussed, true. PGE2 has marked oxytocin action, while PGF2 alpha has tocolytic. Tocolytic means uterine relaxant. It is a false statement. Remember, all prostaglandins, they have oxytocin action. They don't have tocolytic action. They don't relax uterine muscle. They all contract uterine muscle. Now, PGE2 is a bronchodilator, absolutely true. While F2 alpha is a bronchoconstriction, absolutely true, which we have already discussed in the summary. Okay, so the answer is C. C is the false state. Now, misoprostol is, we know that misoprostol is a synthetic PGE1 analog. Okay, that we already know. True statement about thromboxane A2 is, it is formed in platelet. The answer is absolutely true. With the help of an enzyme, thromboxane synthase. Aspirin can inhibit production, true, because aspirin is a COX inhibitor. It is prothrombotic, yes, it causes aggregation of platelet. It has antiplatelet activity. This is an opposite statement. It is a false statement. It rather has aggregatory activity. It causes aggregation of platelet. Okay. Now, all of the following are correct statements, except we have to find the false statement. Prostaglandin and leukotrienes, they are derived from arachidonic acid. The answer is absolutely true. COX-2 induced by cytokines at the site of inflammation? Yes. Now remember that COX enzyme is generally of two type, COX-1 and COX-2. COX-1 enzyme, remember, it is a constitutive enzyme. Constitutive enzyme means it is present in all body cells and it is continuously functioning. Continuously functioning means it is a housekeeping function, that some amount of prostaglandins are continuously formed. While COX-2 enzyme is an inducible enzyme, it suddenly gets start functioning when we need certain higher amount of prostaglandin. Higher amount of prostaglandin is required during inflammation. But in certain areas, COX-2 can be constitutive also. It can be constitutive in cases of endothelial cell. COX-2 can also be constitutive at endothelial cell. You will write platelets, sorry, endothelial cells. Second, you will write kidney, brain and fetus. Here it can function continuously just like COX-1. But otherwise, in all other organs, it's an inducible enzyme. So if you talk about this question, COX-2 is induced by cytokines at the site of inflammation, true. COX-1 is an inducible enzyme? No, COX-1 is not an inducible enzyme. It is a constitutive enzyme. Leukotriene causes smooth muscle contraction, true. That is why leukotriene causes asthma, which we have already discussed. So the answer is, false statement is C. Now therapeutic use of prostaglandin E1. Include all of the following except medical termination of pregnancy, true. Impotency, true, yes. L-prostadil is used for the treatment of erectile dysfunction. Pulmonary artery hypertension, false. Remember, in pulmonary artery hypertension, we rather use PGI2 analog, not PGE1. Maintenance of patent ductus arteriosus, the answer is true. We use misoprostol and L-prostadil, hence the answer is C. Now, which of the following statement is true regarding latanoprost? Now, latanoprost, if you remember, it was a prostaglandin F2 alpha analog. Okay? And it was given as an eye drop for the treatment of glaucoma. So, the first statement is absolutely true. It is a derivative of prostaglandin F2 alpha analog and it is used in the treatment of glaucoma. So, this is the answer. But let's discuss other option. It is a selective alpha 1 blocker used in BPH hypertrophy. The answer is false. Here the drug is generally prazosin. They are talking about a drug prazosin out here. It's a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor given in enlarged prostate. It is false. Here they are talking about a drug finasteride, 5-alpha, and dutasteride. It is a PGE2 analog given intravaginally for cervical priming or cervical ripening. False. Here they are talking about dinoprostone. Okay, so the correct statement was it is a prostaglandin F2 alpha analog used in glaucoma. A newborn was diagnosed with transposition of great vessels. While preparing this infant for surgery, medical team needed to keep ductus arteriosus open. And we know that for opening of ductus arteriosus, we use PGE1. Either we use misoprostol or we use L-prostadil. And remember, this indomethacin or ibuprofen now is considered drug of choice, is given for closure of ductus arteriosus. Because it will reduce, they are NSAIDs, they will reduce prostaglandin E1 formation. Okay. Now, prostaglandin used in prevention of duodenal ulcer was misoprostol. We discussed misoprostol is given in peptic ulcers. The only prostaglandin given in peptic ulcer was misoprostol. All of the followings are indication of eicosanoids or their inhibitors. So they are asking about what are the uses of prostaglandin in NSAIDs. Abortion, it's absolutely true. Essential hypertension, no. They are rather used in pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension means blood pressure in pulmonary arteries have been increased. Essential hypertension means blood pressure in systemic arteries have increased. Patent ductus arteriosus, true. Transposition of great artery, yes, true. To maintain this ductus arteriosus opened. So the answer here is essential hypertension, no. Prostaglandins are used in pulmonary hypertension. Now, which of the following component is a slow reacting substance of anaphylaxis? I told you slow reacting substance of anaphylaxis was LTC4 and LTD4. They are considered as a slow reacting substance for anaphylaxis. Short form is SRSA. So the answer out here is LTC4. Okay. Now, prostaglandin E2 analog can be used in all of the following except E2. Remember the drug if you remember. Dinoprostol. I told you three uses of dinoprostol: cervical ripening, okay, second trimester abortion, and hyadatiform mole removal. So the answer out here is cervical priming or cervical ripening. Okay, for the treatment of patent ductus arteriosus, we give PGE1, not E2. Okay, for bronchial asthma, we don't use any generally prostaglandin. NSAID induced peptic ulcer, again E1. Misoprostol. Which prostaglandin is given for cervical ripening? The answer is PGE2. Bone resorption or osteoporosis is caused by? Again, PGE2. Okay. Inhibitor of platelet aggregation includes the which prostaglandin is antiplatelet? We discussed PGI2. Most common cause of Möbius syndrome is? Möbius syndrome we discussed with misoprostol. But remember, Möbius syndrome is caused by misoprostol, which is a teratogenic effect. It is also caused by thalidomide. But with misoprostol, it is most common. Hence, we will go by the answer misoprostol. Okay. Prostaglandins analog have therapeutic utility in all except, we have to find the except statement. Maintaining the patency of ductus arteriosus, true. We use PGE1. Pulmonary hypertension, true, PGI2. Impotency, true, we use PGE1, L-prostadil. Inflammatory bowel disease, false. Remember, they are absolutely, prostaglandins are absolutely contraindicated in inflammation. Because prostaglandin, they themselves causes inflammation. So in any inflammatory condition, prostaglandins are absolutely contraindicated. Because they themselves cause inflammation. Now, a 20-year-old male has been treated with Zafirlukast. Now, Zafirlukast, remember, is a leukotriene, as we had discussed in asthma chapter, receptor blocker. It blocks cis-LT1 receptors, which is present on bronchial muscles. Hence, it is given for treatment of asthma. So, keeping this thing in mind, can you tell me in which part A, B, C or D it will act? So, Zafirlukast is a leukotriene receptor blocker. Can we say it will block cis-LT1 receptor? So, the answer is C. Okay. But what about the drug which inhibits phospholipase A2? We will write the drug which inhibits phospholipase A2 is corticosteroids. Remember, corticosteroids, they inhibit phospholipase A2. How do they inhibit corticosteroids? They inhibit indirectly. First, they will increase the level of annexin protein inside the cell. And this annexin protein inhibit phospholipase A2. So they increase the production of annexin, which can lead to this. The drug which inhibit LOX enzyme is, we will write, Zilutone. It is given in asthma. Okay. And here we will write the drug leukotriene receptor blocker like Zafirlukast, Montelukast, etc. Okay, Montelukast, etc. Third is Pranlukast. So they block cis-LT1 receptor. And bronchodilatation is caused by many drugs like beta-2 agonist, like salbutamol, ipratropium-like drug, which are anticholinergic drug. We can also write theophyllines. They are direct bronchodilator. Okay. So this is the... Now the last question is, which prostaglandin is used in NSAID-induced peptic ulcer? The answer is misoprostol. Okay. So this is all about prostaglandins. Thank you very much. Hello all. So let's start with now autocoids part, that is NSAIDs. Now what are NSAIDs? NSAIDs, we know they are known as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Okay. And what is their mechanism of action? These non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they inhibit cyclooxygenase enzyme. And cyclooxygenase enzyme is required for production of prostaglandins. Hence, they reduce the production of prostaglandins. This is their definition. Now, the first point is that all non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they are reversible inhibitor. They are reversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. Except one. Except aspirin. Except aspirin. Aspirin is also known as acetyl salicylic acid. So this aspirin is a rather irreversible inhibitor. Okay? It is an irreversible inhibitor. Now remember, any drug which is an irreversible inhibitor binds with an enzyme with a covalent bond. Reversible inhibitors, they bind with an enzyme with ionic bonds, which can be broken down in watery media. And that is why it is known as suicide inhibition. The enzyme will become permanently dead. So keeping this thing in mind, the definition. So aspirin is the only NSAID which is an irreversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. So the first question is asking, all of the following NSAIDs are reversible inhibitor, except the answer is aspirin. Okay. Now, which of the following NSAID has a very good tissue penetration? Good tissue penetration with the concentration in synovial fluid 3 times longer than the plasma. The answer is diclofenac sodium. So diclofenac sodium comes with the brand name Voviron and Volini cream. They are very given very commonly. It is the best NSAID which is very commonly used as a topical drug or topical cream for the treatment of arthritis also. Okay. So diclofenac is the best NSAID which can be given topically. Okay. Now which NSAID is given once a daily? The answer is piroxicam. Remember, piroxicam is overall the longest acting NSAID. So diclofenac we had discussed, best topical penetration. Piroxicam is the longest acting NSAID overall, and hence it is given OD. OD means once a day. Rest generally all NSAIDs are given twice a day or thrice a day. Now the point is, why it is the longest acting drug? Because it undergoes enterohepatic circulation. It means it gets excreted out in bile, but from the bile it again comes back into the blood. So it undergoes enterohepatic reabsorption continuously. That is why it is the longest acting NSAID. Piroxicam. How to remember? Cam word is coming, so ek kaam karta rahega. It will continue doing kaam. Kaam means work, so it will be the longest acting drug. Okay? So the answer is piroxicam. Now N-acetylcysteine, remember N-acetylcysteine reduces the severity of hepatic necrosis due to, remember N-acetylcysteine, it is an antioxidant and it regenerates glutathione stores, and the stores of glutathione get depleted in cases of paracetamol poisoning. Hence, N-acetylcysteine is considered as an antidote for paracetamol poisoning. Paracetamol is also known as acetaminophen. Now, what are the other drugs which can be given apart from N-acetylcysteine in paracetamol poisoning? You can also give methionine. Same reason. It is also an antioxidant. You can also give cysteamine. But remember, the best drug we have is N-acetylcysteine, which is considered as a drug of choice or antidote for paracetamol poisoning, because paracetamol poisoning causes damage of liver due to accumulation of one metabolite known as NAPQI. NAPQI is the toxic metabolite generated by paracetamol, which gets accumulated due to depletion of glutathione. Now, which of the following is not true regarding NSAID? Which of the following is not true regarding NSAID? That NSAID, they reduce the effect of antihypertensive drug. The answer is absolutely true. Now, why NSAID reduce the effect of antihypertensive drug? Because NSAIDs, they are vasoconstrictor. That means they will cause hypertension. The reason is NSAIDs, they reduce the level of prostaglandin I2. And prostaglandin I2 produces vasodilatation, because of the reduced level of prostaglandin I2, it will produce vasoconstriction, which will produce hypertension. They can be given by topical route of administration. The answer is absolutely true. They are given by creams, they are given by eye drops, etc. NSAIDs, they cause nephrotoxicity. The answer is absolutely true. They are nephrotoxic drug. The reason is, remember, the PGE1, it increases the blood supply to kidney. Hence, if the level of prostaglandin E1 decreases, remember, they reduce the blood supply to the kidney. They reduce the blood supply to the kidney. Because of this reason, what will happen? They cause damage to the organ of a kidney, which reduce already very less blood supply. It causes papillary necrosis. This condition is also known as analgesic nephropathy. And because of this analgesic nephropathy, one NSAID got banned. That NSAID was phenacetin. Phenacetin got banned because of this reason. And as they are reducing the blood supply to the kidney, remember, they have anti-diuretic action. Because if the blood supply to the kidney will reduce, the blood will not be converted into urine. Now, the last statement is, they are effective in neuropathic pain. The answer is absolutely false. So, this is the false statement. Remember, NSAIDs as well as opioids like morphine, they are given in all type of pain except neuropathic pain. They are not effective in neuropathic pain. Remember, in neuropathic pain, we give anti-epileptic drugs and antidepressant drugs because we have to suppress neurons. Here, the pain is not due to inflammation. So, NSAIDs and opioids, they are not effective in only one type of pain, that is neuropathic pain. Now, cardiotoxicity is seen by which of the following NSAID? That answer for this question number is rofecoxib. A. Rofecoxib. Now, rofecoxib, at its ending with the word coxib, remember, it is a selective COX-2 inhibitor. Any NSAID which is ending with the word coxib is a selective COX-2 inhibitor. Now, selective COX-2 inhibitor, what they will do, suppose this is a platelet. Remember, in platelet, we have COX-1 enzyme. And COX-1 enzyme forms thromboxane A2, which causes platelet aggregation. Okay? While endothelial cells, it has COX-2 enzyme, which forms prostaglandin I2, which has antiplatelet action. Now, the point is, if we give a selective COX-2 inhibitor, what will happen? The level of prostaglandin I2 decreases and the level of thromboxane A2 is more. Hence, it will cause deposition of platelet in a blood vessel. And if the platelet gets deposited in a blood vessel, it will form thrombus, which can lead to blockage of end arteries. If there is blockage of end arteries like coronary artery, it can lead to MI. Myocardial infarction, cerebral artery, it can lead to stroke. So, selective COX-2 inhibitor like rofecoxib, they got banned because of MI and stroke, myocardial infarction and stroke. So, selective COX-2 inhibitor, they got banned because of this reason. So, you must remember this point. It's a very important point. Okay? Selective COX-2 inhibitor. So, they get banned. Now, the point is, the only NSAID which is given as an antiplatelet drug is aspirin. Apart from aspirin, no other NSAID is given as an antiplatelet drug. And remember, aspirin is a drug of choice for MI and stroke. The reason is, aspirin inhibits both COX-1 as well as COX-2 enzyme. And aspirin is a non-selective COX inhibitor. It inhibits both COX enzyme in an irreversible fashion. As it is an irreversible inhibitor of COX enzyme, platelet, the thromboxane A2 level will reduce, and endothelial cell, PGI2 level will reduce. Now, the point is, endothelial cell, they contain nucleus. After some times, they can make a fresh COX enzyme and they can increase the level of prostaglandin I2. But platelet have no genetic material, no nucleus. Thromboxane A2 level is permanently reduced. Hence, the net effect will come out to be antiplatelet effect. Hence, aspirin is the only NSAID which is given as an antiplatelet drug in a very low dose, and it is the drug of choice for MI and stroke. while selective COX-2 inhibitor, they got banned because they were causing MI and stroke. Now, the therapeutic efficacy of antihypertensive drugs are blunted by, the answer is by NSAID. Why? We have already discussed, because antihypertensive drug, they reduce the synthesis of vascular prostacyclin. And we know that prostacyclin causes vasodilatation. If the level of prostacyclin reduces, they will cause vasoconstriction. Hence, the blood pressure level will increase. Aspirin inhibit which of the following enzymes? We know that aspirin is a COX inhibitor, cyclooxygenase. Which NSAID undergoes enterohepatic circulation? The answer is piroxicam. That is why it was the longest acting NSAID. Now, aspirin should be used with caution in which of the following group of patients because of the following reason. Let's see what is the true statement. In diabetes, because it can cause hyperglycemia, it's a false statement. Aspirin should be used with precaution in diabetes because it rather causes hypoglycemia. The reason is prostaglandin E1, remember, it inhibits insulin release. And remember, aspirin is a COX enzyme, COX inhibitor. It decreases the level of prostaglandin I2, hence the level of insulin is increased. Hence, it may cause hypoglycemia. In children with viral disease, because of risk of acute renal failure, false. Remember, aspirin should not be given in children with viral disease because of the risk of acute liver failure. It is not acute renal failure, it is rather acute liver failure. This condition is known as RACE syndrome. Children with viral infection with aspirin can lead to RACE syndrome. In gout, because it can increase the level of uric acid, true. Aspirin, remember, increases uric acid level. Okay, aspirin inhibits the excretion of uric acid, so it's a true statement. Aspirin in pregnancy, because of the risk of teratogenicity, false. Remember, aspirin can be given in pregnancy. Okay, aspirin can be given in pregnancy. So let's move forward now. A patient is on aspirin will have. Now we know that aspirin is an antiplatelet drug. And platelet are the first cells which control bleeding. Bleeding time, remember, is depend upon the number of platelet. Hence, the remember all antiplatelet drug, there is increase in bleeding time. So the answer is bleeding time. What about clotting time? Clotting time is seen by anticoagulant. Anticoagulant drug, they increase clotting time. And prothrombin time and activated partial prothrombin time, they are the type of clotting time. Okay? They are one of the type of clotting time. So, antiplatelet drug, remember bleeding time, which is an aspirin. Anticoagulant drug, clotting time, PT and APTT are clotting time. A 20-year-old female weighing 255 kilogram admitted to emergency with 10 gram of paracetamol with alcohol. One point you have to remember, alcohol increases the toxicity of paracetamol. Remember this point. Alcohol increases the toxicity of paracetamol. A serum level of 400 microgram per ml was recorded. Now remember one point, if the level of paracetamol is more than 250 microgram per ml after 4 hours, or if it is more than, or if it is more than, or if it is more than, just a moment, so or if it is more than, we will write, so if the level of paracetamol is more than 250 microgram per ml after 4 hours, or if it is more than 30 microgram per ml after 15 hours, there is a high risk of hepatotoxicity. It can lead to sudden liver failure. The pattern of liver failure with paracetamol is known as centrilobular necrosis with periportal sparing. This is how paracetamol will damage liver. Centrilobular necrosis means the cells around central vein will die and around portal triad will be spared. Now, this is a clear-cut case of a paracetamol poisoning. As you are seeing, the level is around 400 at 6 hours. So there is a clear case of paracetamol poisoning. So what to do? First point is, question is asking, gastric lavage is mandatory. It is false. Remember, gastric lavage is only given in early cases. And how to give gastric lavage? We give by activated charcoal. It should be administered, yes, but it should be given in early cases. Abnormality of kidney functions are likely to present? Answer is yes, but the characteristic toxicity of paracetamol is hepatotoxicity. Okay, this is the best answer we can choose among these options. Okay, but remember, kidney failure can also occur in paracetamol toxicity. It can lead to acute renal failure or acute tubular necrosis. Paracetamol poisoning can also lead to coagulopathy, increase in bleeding. It can also lead to metabolic acidosis. But remember, the characteristic toxicity is hepatotoxicity because the blood level, as you are seeing, is more than the required range. Now, true statement regarding aspirin toxicity is, tinnitus is an early symptom. The answer is absolutely true. Aspirin causes tinnitus. The fatal dose of aspirin is 10 to 30 grams. It's absolutely true. It can cause hyperthermia and tachypnea. It's absolutely true. Children can tolerate much higher dose. This is the false statement. Remember, aspirin toxicity can occur even in lower doses in children. It can occur even in lower doses in children as compared to adults. So remember, children cannot tolerate much higher dose of aspirin. It is rather adults which can tolerate the much higher dose of aspirin. COX pathway is inhibited by NSAIDs. And try to find out two NSAIDs. Indomethacin and diclofenac are NSAIDs. Okay. Now, which of the following drug inhibits platelet cyclooxygenase? Okay. We know that platelet cyclooxygenase is inhibited by NSAIDs. But the question is asking reversibly. We know that aspirin is an irreversible inhibitor, while brufen is an NSAID which is a reversible inhibitor. The answer is ibuprofen. Okay, L-prostadil is a PGE1 analog. It's a prostaglandin E1 analog. Prednisolone is a corticosteroid. Okay, the answer is reversible NSAID, brufen. Which of the following drug reduces the activity of phospholipase A2? This point we have already discussed in the last section of prostaglandin. The answer is corticosteroid. Corticosteroid, remember, they increase the formation of annexins molecule. And annexins, they inhibit phospholipase A2. And phospholipase A2 forms prostaglandins and all those molecules. Hence, the answer is prednisolone. Prednisolone is a type of corticosteroid. Okay, aspirin in low dose produces long-lasting inhibition of platelet cyclooxygenase. Why? Because it is an irreversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. We know that aspirin is an irreversible inhibitor of COX enzyme, and platelet, they have no DNA. There is no nucleus in platelet. There is no DNA. Hence, platelet cannot synthesize new COX enzyme, because it is synthesized by transcription of DNA. Hence, this COX enzyme will now permanently get inhibited in platelet. So the answer is, why it causes long-lasting effect? Because platelet cannot synthesize fresh COX molecule. Okay, fresh COX molecule. Now, true statement regarding COX-2. We had already discussed that COX-1 was a constitutive enzyme and COX-2 is an inducible enzyme. Okay, and all types of COX enzymes are inhibited by indomethacin. Indomethacin is a non-selective COX inhibitor. That means it inhibits COX-1 as well as COX-2. So it will inhibit both. It's an inducible enzyme, COX-2. Its answer is yes. Remember, COX-1 is a constitutive enzyme which functions continuously. COX-2 is an inducible enzyme. It functions when we need sudden inflammation. It has cytoprotective, it generates cytoprotective prostaglandin in general mucosa. The answer is absolutely false. It generally, okay, It generally increases the prostaglandin, which causes inflammation, and inflammation, remember, generally causes damage of cells. It is found only in fetus tissue? The answer is no. It is found in all tissues, all cells of the body. It is found in all cells. Cox enzymes are present in all cells of the body. Okay. Now, 20th question. All of the following action of aspirin are mediated by inhibition of prostaglandin synthesis except. The first, remember, prostaglandin, they increase pain. And we know that aspirin is an NSAID and it inhibits prostaglandin, hence it will cause analgesia or decrease in pain. Absolutely right. We know that prostaglandin open ductus arteriosus. And NSAID, can we say it will inhibit prostaglandin, it will lead to closure of ductus arteriosus? The answer is absolutely true. Now, prostaglandin, one of the prostaglandin is thromboxane A2. Thromboxane A2 causes platelet aggregation. Hence, if you will give NSAID, NSAID will also inhibit Cox enzyme, thromboxane level A2 will decrease. Hence, it will increase the bleeding. Why? Because the platelet cannot aggregate. True. Okay. Now, what about hyperventilation? Hyperventilation is not the function of prostaglandin. Remember this part. So, hyperventilation depends upon respiratory centers. That depends upon acidity like H+ and CO2 level. Ventilation depends upon the blood acidic level of H+ molecule and CO2 level. Now, true statement about aspirin is, so we have to find a true statement. A febrile patient acute overdose of aspirin produces hypothermia, it is false. Remember, aspirin rather produces hyperthermia. Why aspirin produces hyperthermia? It is not hypo, it is rather hyperthermia. Why? Because aspirin causes uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation. It causes uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation. It means the NADP, the electron transport chain, we know that ATP molecules must be synthesized. It inhibits the synthesis of ATP molecule and all the energy is converted into heat. It will lead to hyperthermia. Aspirin suppresses flushing associated with large dose of nicotinic acid. Aspirin suppresses flushing occurring with large doses of nicotinic acid. The answer is absolutely true. Aspirin is given for nicotine or niacin induced flushing. It's absolutely true because niacin induced flushing occurs due to increase in prostaglandin D2 level. Prostaglandin D2 level causes cutaneous flushing. Aspirin will inhibit this level. So it's a true statement. Aspirin therapy prevents granulomatous lesion and cardiac complications of acute rheumatic fever. The answer is aspirin therapy prevents granulomatous lesion and cardiac complications of acute rheumatic fever. The answer is true. It also inhibits. And long-term aspirin increases the risk of developing colorectal cancer. The answer is false. Aspirin is a drug of choice in reducing the risk of, it rather reduces the risk of developing colorectal cancer. Okay, so the incorrect statement is A and D. Phenylbutazone is an NSAID and it got banned. Why? Because it got banned because it was causing agranulocytosis or bone marrow suppression. So just this point you have to remember, because it's a sulfa containing drug, sulfa drugs may cause bone marrow suppression. A truck driver which requires a close attention presented to hospital with minor soft tissue injury, which NSAID would you not prescribe? Remember, the person who requires close attention, we don't prescribe indomethacin because indomethacin causes sedation. Indomethacin causes loss of incoordination of movement or loss of coordination ataxia. It can cause seizures. That is why it is absolutely contraindicated in those professions which requires close attention, like pilots, truck driver, machinery operator. Okay. Now, indomethacin is also absolutely contraindicated in epilepsy patient because it can cause seizures. So these are the contraindications of indomethacin. Okay. Now, NSAID proposed to be acting via inhibition of COX-3 enzyme. The answer of this very peculiar question is paracetamol. Remember, COX-3 is found to be present in brain, especially of dog. In human, it is still elucidated. And remember, in brain, it decreases pain and it decreases fever. Hence, this paracetamol is given as an antipyretic and analgesic agent. But remember, it paracetamol does not act outside the brain. Hence, remember, paracetamol has no anti-inflammatory action. It cannot reduce inflammation. So paracetamol only and only is used for pain and fever. It has no anti-inflammatory action. So remember this part. A patient comes to you with complaining that whenever he takes aspirin, a headache develops and shortness of breath. Shortness of breath could be asthma. Which of the following is partly responsible? The answer is, it is due to formation of leukotrienes. The point is, we know that all prostaglandins and leukotrienes, they are formed from arachidonic acid. Now, arachidonic acid can be converted into COX pathway. Through COX pathway, it will form prostaglandin and thromboxane A2. Arachidonic acid can also be converted into LOX pathway into leukotrienes. Okay? Like leukotriene B4, leukotriene C4, leukotriene D4. Now, the point is, if you will inhibit COX pathway by NSAIDs like aspirin. So aspirin is an NSAID, it inhibits COX pathway. Arachidonic acid will be diverted into LOX pathway and leukotriene causes allergic reactions like asthma. That is why we give leukotriene receptor antagonist in asthma, Montelukast, Zafirlukast. So leukotrienes may cause asthma. Okay? So if you will inhibit this COX enzyme, arachidonic acid pathway will divert towards LOX pathway. A college student produced came to emergency after taking overdose of a non-prescription drug. Patient is confused, lethargic, hyperventilating, dehydrated, arterial blood gas demonstrated, metabolic acidosis. So, a non-prescription drug could be NSAID because they are over-the-counter drug, they don't require any prescription. And NSAIDs, remember, they are acidic drugs. That is why it can lead to metabolic acidosis. And acidic drug, remember, causes hyperventilation because our respiratory centers are stimulated by this. Now, why it is dehydrated? Because all these NSAIDs, they cause severe nausea and vomiting. In the management of the patient, which is not likely to be any therapeutic value. Now, the point is, for any acidic drug, we do alkalinization of urine, it's absolutely true. We have to correct metabolic acidosis, absolutely true. Gastric lavage after 4 hours, it's false. Remember, in gastric lavage should be given before 4 hours. Because all acidic drugs in the presence of stomach HCl, they convert it into lipid soluble molecule and they get rapidly absorbed from stomach. Acidic drugs, they get absorbed from stomach, so they get rapidly absorbed within 4 hours, so they should not be given after 4 hours. Treatment with N-acetylcysteine, true, it is the antidote for a drug known as paracetamol. And paracetamol is a type of NSAID. Okay, so this is the answer. Now, which of the following is aspirin? We know aspirin is acetyl salicylic acid. Okay, it is acetyl salicylic acid. Which of the following is non-opioid analgesic that does not inhibit prostaglandin? Remember, the answer for this question is nifopam. Nifopam does not inhibit prostaglandin synthesis. Nifopam is rather SNDRI. It is serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine, reuptake inhibitor. And it is also given as an analgesic agent to reduce pain in cases of migraine. And it is also given in post-anesthetic shivering. As an analgesic. Now, ibuprofen, we know, is an NSAID and it inhibits COX pathway, cyclooxygenase. The drug which causes analgesic nephropathy and got banned. I told you this drug shortly before when we were discussing the side effects of NSAID. It was phenacetin. Phenacetin got banned because of analgesic nephropathy like papillary necrosis. Now all are true about COX-2 enzyme except, so we have to find the false statement. COX-2 enzyme is constitutively expressed on some cell surface, true. Now remember, COX-2 is generally an inducible enzyme, but it could be constitutive, that means continuously function in kidney, brain, endothelial cell and fetus in this condition. Activation of COX-2 leads to ulceroprotective effect. The answer is false. Remember, in our stomach, there is rather COX-1 enzyme. COX-1 enzyme forms prostaglandin E1 and prostaglandin E1 provides ulcer protective effect. Hence, this is the false statement. Instead of COX-2 here, it should be COX-1. It induces at the site of inflammation. Answer is true. When it gets induced, it causes inflammation. It utilized in generation of eicosanoid. Yes, they are synthesized from eicosanoid. True. So the incorrect statement we have is B. Okay. All are true about Reye syndrome. We discussed Reye syndrome was seen with NSAIDs, especially aspirin, especially in children. These are the characteristics of Reye syndrome. Children more than adults in presence of viral infection. Which viral? You will write influenza virus, chickenpox, etc. Because this viral infection causes very high grade fever. For fever control, we can give NSAID and it can cause rashes. Now, when NSAID is given in children in viral infection, it can lead to hepatic encephalopathy. That means liver will get failed and toxins, they will enter into brain because liver detoxifies toxin and the brain will also get damaged. This condition is known as Reye syndrome. Okay, so the answer is for this question is Reye syndrome, hepatic encephalopathy, true. It is seen with ampicillin therapy, false. No, it is seen with aspirin therapy, not ampicillin therapy. Fever and rash, true. Viral associated, true. So the answer is ampicillin. So this is all about the Reye syndrome part, you must remember. Now, cyclooxygenase enzyme is not inhibited by aspirin, it is inhibited. Phenylbutazone, NSAID, diclofenac inhibited, it is warfarin. Warfarin is not an NSAID, it is rather an anticoagulant drug. Development of hepatic centrilobular necrosis. The characteristic pattern of this necrosis we have already discussed is due to paracetamol or acetaminophen overdose. Can be prevented and effectively by which of the following if given within few hours of ingestion. We know that the antidote for paracetamol poisoning was N-acetylcysteine. Okay, the antidote for paracetamol poisoning is N-acetylcysteine. Rofecoxib, again a same question, COX-2 inhibitor. It was withdrawn from the market. Why? Because it was causing ischemic heart disease like MI and stroke. Use of aspirin in children with viral disease will lead to Reye syndrome. So aspirin, children with viral disease, Reye syndrome. Long-term use of aspirin in rheumatoid arthritis is limited by because it causes gastric mucosal damage or peptic ulcers. Remember, they are the two main causes of peptic ulcers, that is NSAID and H. pylori. The reason is in stomach. Remember, COX-1 enzyme is there. COX-1 enzyme forms PGE2. This PGE2, remember, it decreases HCl production. And this PGE2 increases the protective factors like mucus. Hence, if you will give an NSAID like aspirin, the level of PGE2 will reduce, more HCl will be secreted and peptic ulcer. Now remember, selective COX-2 inhibitor. Selective COX-2 inhibitor like COXIPS, any drug ending with a COXIPS, remember, will not cause peptic ulcer. There is no peptic ulcer with selective COX-2 inhibitor. And paracetamol also do not cause peptic ulcer because paracetamol inhibit COX-3 enzyme. Okay? So it is mainly seen with the NSAID which inhibit COX-1 enzyme. For pain control in a patient having history of GI bleed, which of the following is given? The answer is rofecoxib. Because selective COX-2 inhibitor will not cause GI bleed. Which of the following statement is true of ketorolac? Remember, ketorolac is the only NSAID which can be given IV or IM for post-operative pain or post-operative analgesia. Agreed? When a patient cannot take a drug orally. And in post-op analgesia, remember, overall the drug of choice is opioids like morphine. But if we compare the effect of ketorolac with morphine, you will write ketorolac has equal efficacy. It can produce same level of effect as compared to morphine. So remember, the answer is it analgesic efficacy is equal to morphine. So it is given when a patient cannot take a drug orally. It is the only intravenous or intramuscular NSAID. Which of the following has covalent? Covalent means irreversible. So the only drug which is an irreversible inhibitor of COX enzyme was aspirin. Okay, irreversible inhibitor. So hypertension is caused by all of the following. The answer is aspirin. It causes hypertension. True. We have already discussed NSAIDs. They cause hypertension because of vasoconstriction. Steroid also causes hypertension. True. Because steroids, they have mineralocorticoid activity. Mineralocorticoid activity will cause sodium and water retention. Or you can say they have antidiuretic effect. Now, the drug which will not cause hypertension will be diuretics. Diuretics are rather drug of choice for the treatment of hypertension. Okay? Which of the following is not a non-opioid analgesic? So you have to find an opioid analgesic in this case. Remember, it is an NSAID, it is an NSAID, it is an NSAID. Methadone is an opioid. Okay? While all other drugs are non-opioids. Relative selective COX-2 inhibitor. Now, relative selective COX-2 inhibitor means the drugs which are more of COX-2 as compared to COX-1. So they are also known as preferential COX-2 inhibitor. The drugs are NMAID. Preferential COX-2 inhibitor, nimesulide, meloxicam, aceclofenac, diclofenac, and etodolac. They are preferential COX-2 inhibitor, and the answer is nimesulide. The answer is nimesulide. Aspirin has all of the following property except. So aspirin has all of the following property except, let's talk about this question number 44 now. Now, aspirin brings down elevated temperatures. The answer is true. It has antipyretic effect. It brings down normal temperature, false. Because fever is elevated body temperature. It cannot bring down the normal body temperature. It can only bring down the elevated body temperature. It prevents platelet aggregation. True. That is why aspirin is the drug of choice for MI and stroke. It has anti-inflammatory property. So it has anti-platelet effect. It is given in rheumatoid arthritis. True. Because it has anti-inflammatory property. Anti-inflammatory problem. So aspirin is used as an antipyretic, antiplatelet and anti-inflammatory. But remember, in very low dose, it is acting as an antiplatelet. Very low dose of aspirin is selective antiplatelet. The major toxicity of paracetamol or acetaminophen involves liver. It causes liver. We have already discussed. Chief advantage of ketorolac. We have already discussed certain points about ketorolac. It is given IV or IM, post-operative analgesia, opioid, equal efficacy. So let's solve this question. The chief advantage of using ketorolac over aspirin is that in the former, it can be given as a parenteral formulation which can be given IV or IM. Remember, ketorolac can be given IV or IM. Rest all other NSAIDs, they are given only and only orally. Okay, so remember this part. NSAID lacking anti-inflammatory action, the answer is paracetamol. We have discussed paracetamol is a selective COX-3 inhibitor. It has no action on outside, the COX enzyme outside, because COX-3 is present in brain only. So it is only and only antipyretic and analgesic with no anti-inflammatory action. All of the following effects are produced by inhibitors of prostaglandin synthesis. Inhibitors of prostaglandin synthesis are known as NSAIDs, except they prolong bleeding time, true. Why? Because they have antiplatelet effect. They prolong prothrombin time, false. Prothrombin time is rather prolonged by anticoagulant drug. So this is the answer. Now, they prolong labor, true. Why? Because they inhibit prostaglandin. Prostaglandin causes uterine contraction. So they have a tocolytic effect, yes. And indomethacin is used as a tocolytic. They damage gastric mucosal ulcer, yes, because they cause peptic ulcers. So the incorrect statement is B. Use of aspirin in diabetic patient, we have already discussed, can lead to hypoglycemia. Why hypoglycemia? Because diabetes, prostaglandin E1, it stimulate insulin, it inhibit insulin release. If you inhibit prostaglandin, insulin level will increase, which may lead to diabetes. Okay, which of the following action of aspirin is manifested in very lowest dose? We have just discussed this question. It is antiplatelet effect. The answer is antiplatelet effect. Okay, the dose of antiplatelet dose of aspirin is 40 to 320 milligram. As an anti-inflammatory dose, 2 to 5 grams. And the dose of analgesic and antipyretic could be 500 to 800 milligrams. Okay, so the lowest dose, it will act as an antiplatelet drug. So this is the doses of aspirin. Analgesic, that it can cause headache. We had already discussed paradoxical headache is caused by an NSAID known as indomethacin. Indomethacin causes paradoxical headache. Okay. Rofecoxib, selective COX-2 inhibitor compared to indomethacin is. We know that selective COX-2 inhibitor will not cause peptic ulcers. Hence the answer is A. Because in stomach we have only and only COX-1 enzyme. So peptic ulcer is caused by COX-1. Remember, indomethacin is a non-selective COX inhibitor. It inhibits COX-1 and COX-2. Coxib, it inhibits COX-2 enzyme. Peptic ulcer is caused by inhibition of COX-1. Okay, so remember this part. It is likely to be more effective in rheumatoid arthritis. The answer is false. Rheumatoid arthritis, both are effective. Not likely to produce renal complication, false. Because in kidney, we have discussed, there is COX-2 enzyme. And both drugs, they inhibit COX-2 enzyme, which can reduce blood supply to the kidney. Okay, so they all NSAIDs are nephrotoxic drug, whether it is selective COX-2 inhibitor or non-selective COX-2 inhibitor. Aspirin is used in the prophylaxis of myocardial infarction because it inhibits cyclooxygenase enzyme, thereby it produces antiplatelet effect. Because of antiplatelet effect, it is used in prophylaxis of myocardial infarction. A 3-year-old child presented to OPD with the symptoms of influenza. Aspirin is contraindicated because of the risk of RACE syndrome. Because of the risk of RACE syndrome. Individual with alcoholic liver cirrhosis may develop severe hepatotoxicity with paracetamol or acetaminophen that are not toxic. This increased sensitivity to acetaminophen is. Remember how paracetamol toxicity occurs. Let's discuss. Now, paracetamol or acetaminophen, it goes into the liver and it forms a metabolite known as NAPQI. And this NAPQI in toxic dose is removed out of the body by glutathione conjugation. It is attached by glutathione and it is removed out of the body. Now, first of all, this conversion of paracetamol into NAPQI is known as phase 1 reaction. It is carried out by CYP2E1. And then glutathione conjugation occurs. It is known as phase 2 reaction. And it is removed out of the body. Now remember, paracetamol toxicity is due to accumulation of NAPQI. NAPQI accumulation causes hepatotoxicity. Now why it occurs? Because alcohol, isoniazid, they stimulate CYP2E1. If they stimulate CYP2E1, more amount of NAPQI is formed, and alcohol also deplete the stores of glutathione. Hence, the glutathione part is not there. Hence, the level of NAPQI will also increase. Hence, hepatotoxicity due to paracetamol is very commonly seen in alcoholics. That is why if a person is in hangover for headache, we should not prescribe paracetamol. So the answer for this question number 55 is B. Alcohol depletes the stores of glutathione. If you talk about option C, it rather increases the activity of cytochrome P4 enzyme. It is not reduced. Okay. And the last question for NSAID is, paracetamol acts on which receptor? Now, what is the mechanism of action of paracetamol? Remember, paracetamol increases COX, it reduces COX-3 enzyme synthesis by acting on a receptor known as TRPV1 receptor. Now, this receptor is known as transient receptor potential vanilloid receptor. Full form is not receptor. Important. Remember, it is a receptor of cannabinoid system. Cannabinoid receptor. So, the answer is TRPV1 receptors. Okay. So, it's a new hypothesis that you must remember. So, this is all about NSAIDs. Thank you very much. For the complete details, you can log into the video series, complete video series. Thank you very much.